It's March 26, 2024 at the WHO. I'm here with Luis talking about the negotiations on a pandemic treaty. Luis, you want to remind people who you are and the organization you work for?
Well, thank you, James, for this interview. I am Luis Villarroel. I'm director and founder of a Latin American NGO based in Chile called Innovarte, and we work in intellectual property issues and competition with the view of access to knowledge and innovation. And we are here as stakeholders, as technically you say in WHO words, we are an XE organization. So we are here to attend and to listen and to give comments and advice to negotiators.
What do you think are the most divisive issues in the negotiation?
I would say the most divisive, I'm not sure if you call it issue, but the most divisive is the lack of trust and the lack of empathy of the real problems that are behind what country is proposing. I see there's still there is a disconnect there. There are topics that are very that divide negotiators, like benefit sharing or technology transfer, or even finance or governance. But something I think that is in the bottom is the lack of understanding why the content of the provisions that make countries, why they are doing it. For example, I'm not quite sure if countries that are opposing to provisions put forward by the African group and Colombia with regard to assurances that the existing flexibilities of trips should be available without, obstacles in case of a pandemic. For me, it's not clear that the EU, US, who opposed, to this type of statements, understand, why they are asking, or they don't want to see, what they have done in the past that is making these countries to ask something that is obvious,
Luis, how do you describe, you refer to something called the peace clause in the agreement. Could you explain to people what the peace clause was?
Well, I mean, the peace clause is a name for a very, I would say, very modest clause, which states that countries recognize that they have existing flexibilities in the multilateral IP system, mainly in TRIPS, and they have the right to implement those. And also countries are shouldn't be being an obstacle of the use of flexibilities by other countries. So the idea is that if a country within a pandemic, I mean, this is not a treaty that applies to business as usual days. We're talking in a pandemic when we are the whole existence of the humankind might be, in danger. Countries might use what currently is international law and to make use of know-how or innovations that are subject to exclusivity because of a patent or other IP right, and other countries will not put pressure on them not to do it, or other countries will not threat some kind of sanction if they do, or just simply accuse them of not doing what they should do.
Well, is that in or out of the text right now?
Currently, my understanding is something that is within the topics that being discussed. It's in the bureau text, but it's under, you know, the I would say there is a request to be removed from the text, and of course there are other countries who are, you know, defending. But you know, for me, it's very shocking that some countries refuse to agree on that. That they, I mean, it's a principle of sovereignty. So the country shouldn't, you know, being an obstacle of measures for the public interest of other countries. And we are talking about that they are saying we want to be left alone when we are doing something legal under international law, and even that is being questioned.
It is disappointing. Yeah, that they can't agree to that, even in an emergency, right?
Right. I mean that's the what it is really amazing. We are talking a case when maybe a virus might kill the whole continent in a few weeks, and I think that they could not give assurance that in those cases they will not take to a country to trade sanction system, because they do what normally developed countries do in an emergency, that they just, you know, use the knowledge they need to find a solution, despite there is a IP recognized in that country.
Luis, you used to be a government negotiator, and now you're working for an NGO trying to influence government negotiators. So how different is it to be on this side as opposed to being on a government delegation?
Well, I mean, I don't want to influence government. I just want to provide data to governments and interpretation of current international obligations. So if you say my role is capacity building, not to influence. So what's the difference from one side to the other is that it's a good question. Never thought on that. But basically, there is a difference in the sense that when you are a government official, you need to pay attention very closely to all sides and to make a good judgment. And in principle, you don't have a judgment until you hear all parties. So that might be more time consuming to make a decision. And in the case of when you're in civil society, you are in civil society because you have a vision of what it has not been, you know, rightly resolved, and so you have a more clear understanding of things that that you will have as a government, in the sense that you are most close to a vision. But of course, in both cases, you need to be listening to the other, to be, you know, adjusting your vision. Also, I think at least in case of these negotiations, clearly to be a government official, you know, give you access to all the information. That is what is being discussed, is how it's discussed, you know, who is asking, who is refusing something, and that something as civil society, we don't have access in timely manner.
You think you have enough transparency in this negotiation?
As I mentioned with the previous interview, I think that the transparency is extremely low. It's extremely low because, you know, we have to rely on leaked text and what people will tell you in the corridor, and I think that is not healthy in the World Health Organization. We have some not healthy practices because you rely on getting some government to tell you what they are, you know, supposed to keep you know, within themselves. So I think it's a very toxic room because at the end, you know, you have some stakeholders who have, you know, easier access than other stakeholders. So that doesn't seem right.
Before I turn off the video, do you want to add any last thoughts?
Yes, I think that it's too much at stake, and we really need to think that what we will miss if we don't have a treaty, but also what we will miss if we have the wrong treaty. So keep that in mind.